Yeah, that whole tactic though of that we're talking about page 264, where someone has a patent, they don't go after. They usually don't go after you until you're big enough to go after, and that's almost in any industry. For example, someone who has a chip on the patent on like horizontal on-off switch for drives, for hard drives. And it's great because they can make the drive smaller because by shifting the power switch at some point. So lots of people started playing with it, making these drives where the power switch is horizontal. And as soon as the people got big enough and started manufacturing enough of these drives to make enough money on it, then they swooped in with the patent attorney and said, great, these are great hard drives you're making. By the way, license our horizontal power switch. They all said yes, of course, because there was more money to be made in licensing it, distributing the product than it was to not making the product anymore. That happens everywhere. The company I work for now, OpenX, there might be a patent involved in some area of something that we do, and historically in this space, the people who own patents that you do whatever you want with it until you are making, stealing their business or making very significant revenue on this one feature, and then they come out and say, hey, we have a patent. You have to license it, and then everyone says, yes, of course we'll license it because it's in our best interest to license this because the amount of money that we pay in license is a small fraction of what we may be spending for net for offering the product. So that sort of happens very frequently. And that actually comes up a bit in this. My name is Steve Cunningham. I run product and market design for a company called OpenX, and then we build technology for digital advertising, so for ads you see on the internet, for ads on mobile, your phones, for advertising going for IPTV, basically anywhere where advertising is digitally managed, distributed. So if you think of other companies in this space, there's Google, there's Yahoo, who's now offering their product publicly, a company called 24/7 that's owned by WPP. Microsoft used to be in the space. They spent $6 billion to acquire a company called Quantum and had a product like this, and they sort of shut it down. So that's sort of the primary people in the space doing this. After I sort of go through it, the subject of this is sort of looking at open source as a business and product design decision. Also sort of there's that first wave of companies that were started around open source software, and many of them are no longer around. But there's been sort of there's another wave of companies that are coming in and doing open source software. And there's a lot of interesting changes in perspective on how these things are being approached. Our company was started with the ad server initially that we built everything off of was all open source code. And then about 3 years ago, we started figuring out that, hey, this has this massive footprint. There's a lot of economic potential with this if you're not turning to a company. And there's this massive unwinding and just a lot of work to get it in a place where we can turn this into a commercial opportunity, but yet we still are very tied to the open source community as well. So it's how we turned over to proprietary. So let me give you some ideas. We'll walk through some of these concepts that people are exploring now in the second phase of creating open source businesses and designing open source products, and then sort of talk a bit about what we went through and where we are today. Just as sort of like a real life example of some of these things. Are likely more theoretical in the first part. I think the most important thing, interrupt at any time. We can dive into weeds on something. It's better that way. That's why I put it on slides. It's not it should be incredibly formal. I think that the first thing is, I know from my experience, when I started playing with open source software, it was this massive, exciting world of, oh my god, all these people sharing stuff and doing really cool things, and you want to get involved and poke around and contribute your projects, maybe start your own project. And there certainly are a lot of benefits, but I think, at the superficial level, especially when you think of the noise around open source, when you think about the chattiest numbers around the open source community, in many cases, the excitement's around this concept of open source itself, and less about what this thing that happens to be open source is solving. What is this used for? And so the point there is, you know, open source itself is a strategic decision. It's not an end. It might be a means to reach an end, but it shouldn't be the end of the product you're designing. It's just one way to get somewhere. So along those lines, so what do you get if you decide that your software is going to be open source? Like, what are the sort of things that are benefit you? And I think the biggest one, if you look at the examples today of open source software, a lot of the new systems that are coming out that are powering sort of massive infrastructures, it's really the research and development costs tend to go down a bit, because you get companies with similar problems that may not be competing in the same space, but they have similar back-end problems and internal issues they're trying to solve. And you're almost sort of distributing your research and development. No longer is this all on you to solve this problem, and no longer are you paying some company, you know, massive fees or paying massive Oracle licenses or something. So what you're doing is, you know, you're distributing your R&D costs. That seems to be a strong reason to go open source, a strong strategy. Another thing is more, this sort of skirts the line between product design and marketing as well, but it's a competitive differentiation. One of the things about having open source software is that you're almost by definition more flexible than your proprietary competition. And that's a very strong marketing point for a lot of people. If you think of software as a solution, actually as a service, but as a solution, you're buying software or you're going to use software for something. You have a business you're already running. This software is not your business. This software is going to help you do something with your business. And you don't want to sort of change how you work to how this, you know, as far as you're concerned, this black box exists. That's a very big thing, especially when you get into like workflow type tools or anything that involves a business process. And that's where something like open source can give you a step ahead of these black box solutions, because by definition it's flexible. If you don't like how it does something, you can hire a couple developers or hire some company and say, customize this for me. There's all the source code, customize it. Whereas the black box, many times you can't do that, or you have to sort of be a significant enough customer that you can have input into a product roadmap. So that's one, the flexibility is sort of a product design decision, but it's also a much more powerful sort of marketing tool. It can sort of position you ahead of your competition that isn't as willing to customize for a business's needs. And it's also the not proprietary bit too. It's also the hope that in every BD guy's mind, he's like, oh, so if we customize this, that we customize, we own. And he's like, and we can patent it, and we can license it. So there's also that going on there as well. Something to be aware of as well is that, you can't think of open source when you think, okay, sort of distributing research development. It's absolutely not free work. You can't just open source something and expect, you know, the world's best and brightest people to sort of come in and make it work for you. There needs to be someone with a product vision. There needs to be someone who manages it. There needs to be some sense of evangelism to get people excited about this thing you're trying to create, this problem you're trying to solve, and find those like-minded people in other spaces. I have the same concerns. And that takes work, that takes people, that takes headcount, that costs money. Also, in the case of if you're building something proprietary, well, you hire everyone and you sort of dictate what happens and they work for you and you're paying them. With something that's open source, you have this other set of costs. It's called the community. The community is expensive. So there's a lot. You have to somehow publish the code. You have to somehow gather feedback. You have to respond to people's feedback. You have to prioritize it. And that's very taxing. I think you find that the more people involved in something, the more chatter that goes on, the more things potentially slow down, and also the more energy you spend sort of managing this thing, the community. There's a lot of benefits, but there's also a potential harm. And then again, back to the strategy point, I think this is the only time I'll talk about Linux. I don't know if that was a good idea, I think, for Linux users group, but not talking about Linux. If you think Linux really as sort of like a, it's only been the past 10-ish years that Linux has really taken off in the enterprise. Businesses have moved off of Solaris, have moved off of AIX in large chunks. In many spaces, obviously, but there are some more science-based industries that were doing this earlier. But if you think of, Microelectronics, banking, any sort of, you know, fabrication systems. Those were very much, you know, proprietary Unix systems for a very long time. And one of the reasons here that this worked is if you think about how there were a lot of companies that decided that they had a lot more to offer by contributing to this thing called Unix, because they had ancillary services around it that helped stabilize it, that helped get sort of enterprises to think that, okay, we can trust this system. One example of that is like all IBM's contributions to Linux and that sort of community. It was great, and also benefited IBM like you wouldn't believe, because now global services, one, doesn't have to spend as much investing into AIX, and two, can now install undercut Solaris, basically do something to a little bit of price dumping by coming in and saying, great, those are all your Solaris licenses on your proprietary Spark chips. Well, you can get any server you want. We'll plug in the operating system. That doesn't cost me anything. And you've already hired global services, so we'll just tack on a couple of support and professional services fees to it. Yeah. So in that case, for IBM, Linux is an absolute strategy. You know, to them, we can keep competing with proprietary technology, or we can go above, you know, what the operating system is offering and make more money on the secondary pieces. Any questions around that? Next up? No? Okay. So something else these are sort of like, that was sort of, okay, why would you choose open source? So if you're designing a product or you're trying to plan a business, you sort of ask these questions, like why would you go open source? And the next thing is, okay, maybe we decide we're going to go open source, you know, we're leaning that way, but what are all the things that we're potentially going to have to deal with? What are the potential issues that arise if we're distributing open source software? Well, one is choosing the license you're going to distribute it under. Like, are you going to put it under some license, some version of GPL or Creative Commons or the BSD license? Which one are you going to pick? And how is that going to potentially hamstring what you want to do as a business in the future? You have to evaluate that, because you do find that there was a case where we had code under two different licenses, and it was a nightmare trying to merge it back into one. Who owns the code in the project? Like, there is a copyright on this stuff. Legally, there's a copyright. You can say, no, I don't own it, but guess what? Somebody does own it. If you don't want to own it, you still own it. It's yours. So you really have to define who owns it, who owns the product. And then, just for a pure design decision, is who controls the vision for this thing. You know, there's with that horrible joke, the camel is a horse designed by committee, or where the Volvo is a Porsche designed by committee. You know, Michelangelo didn't say, okay, everybody, you know, let's talk about our feelings and paint a picture. Like, he drew the damn thing. You know, as much as people's opinions of, you know, Apple or maybe, you know, the iPhone is a great product that was driven by a singular vision. And you find that in most things. So the singular vision drives a great product. So if you're going to create a great product or something, who's controlling this vision? Because it'll very quickly, similar to the issues we talked about earlier with the you know, community making noise and pulling you which way, you know, who's going to make those decisions, who's going to guide, who's going to communicate that to the community. Again, that's something that needs to be defined up front, otherwise you're going to find that you're spinning for a long time. This is a fun one. Do contributors have the right to contribute? So there's a project now called Cassandra. It's a sort of this, anyone know what Cassandra is? You do? No? Yes. So it's sort of like a distributed hash table storage, very fast, read, write, lookup type thing. People, you know, are running into issues using relational databases. And you're just pulling the same data out very quickly, as well, overhead running a relational database. Well, Cassandra is an open source project. I think we contribute to it, Facebook contributes to it, Twitter contributes to it, one other company contributes to it. One company that Rackspace, I believe. One company that does not contribute to it is Oracle. But what happens if the developer from Oracle in his free time pokes around Cassandra and rejects it and starts committing code? Or starts saying, hey, I saw this thing, and starts committing code. Do you think, you know, I don't know if, what your employment agreements look like, but I know what mine look like. God forbid I do anything related to my field and don't immediately give it to my employer. So, you know, if someone from Oracle goes in and says, hey, great, you know, I know how to solve this memory leak. You can, even if it has nothing to do with it because I saw it from Oracle. Oracle finds out that he commits code. Next thing you know, you've got Oracle saying, guess what? You don't have the right to distribute your product because that piece is ours. And we're either going to, one, demand you take it out, or two, sue you. So if you're going to run this project, you have to be very aware of who's
who's giving you ideas and who's contributing? That's a massive legal issue. There's a lot of liability.
So do you actually, does your company actually, for like the employees to not do any voluntary changes to any open source code? Because
no, in fact, I'll get to it later, but we contribute to a lot of open source projects. However, if an employee contributed to an open source, let's say, for the most simplest case, we run an auction system. So we do a lot of market design, we have these auction systems. If someone out there created an open source auction system and one of our employees contributed to that, well, they would be held to pay at that point. The employee would be in trouble, we'd be demanding stuff gets pulled out because that's our business. That's, to us, is that's what this entity is here to do. Now, however, there's a laundry list of other projects that to us are sort of like tools and pieces and things we need in the back that we contribute to freely. And that's one of the things that we benefit greatly from other people's contributions. And we hope other people benefit from ours.
So do you publish a list of things that employees are allowed to work on or not allowed to work on?
We don't publish a list. It's a case-by-case basis. And what we have to do, and this is similar to what Google does, what Yahoo does, what Microsoft does, believe it or not, Oracle does. What they do is the company puts together a letter and sends it to the project owner saying that, you know, we will contribute to this, and we assign to you any rights and things we develop and check in, or our employees develop and check in. So, again, that's a potential solution to this, but you have to know who your community is and who you're contributing to. Because if you know this guy works for Oracle, you can say, look, this is great, but you can't touch this until we get a letter from Oracle saying that you're allowed to contribute, and then what you contribute belongs to us. And in some cases, they'll do it. In some cases, they'll be, wow, it's a little too close to home, I'm not going to. And again, that also comes back to sort of this concept of, we didn't get much into it, but the product you're designing, you know, we design the system that, you know, runs auctions and manages yield and all sorts of revenue issues. That's what we're out in the market trying to sell. We're not out in the market trying to sell distributed hash tables. We're not out in the market trying to sell binary protocols. So those to us are just things that we're happy to contribute to, and we're happy that other people contribute because it makes our life easier. You know, so you have to understand, this is a very, very common sort of pattern, is things you partner on and things you compete on. And then that's sort of the last major thing to deal with, and this isn't something that comes up often at all, but I touched on earlier, is the community, like dealing with your community. It's sort of a universally understood truth that the squeakiest wheels are the loudest wheels, and it's always in most cases it's the minority. There's exceptions to that, but you usually have a very vocal minority, and it's sort of a silent, happy majority in a lot of products. That's not to say that, you know, all they do is bad. It's just highlighting one of the things that if you don't plan for, you don't understand how to control, you're going to waste a lot of time and a lot of effort. And also, if you think of, you know, being open and flexible as a marketing play, well, if you've got people on your own website screaming at you because you didn't offer, you know, purple widget, a roadmap, you don't use purple widget, yelling at you about purple widgets, it's like, well, that reflects poorly on you from like a marketing and a potential customer perspective. So that's something you have to be very cognizant of when you're sort of putting yourself out there and saying, we're going to let anyone contribute or feel like they have an ownership stake in our primary product. So the next sort of piece, and then this sort of gets into sort of like the next iteration of businesses and open sources. Well, what type of, you know, open source business offering are you going to have? One of the first types of open source businesses where we're going to take open source software, print out a CD, shrink wrap it, and sell it for $5? I'm not going to spend much time on that because that business is terrible. I think everybody understands that business is terrible, but that was sort of like open source. I'm just going to repackage Linux, but, you know, burn a CD, play the book, and sell it for $5. Well, that's not a good business. The next sort of piece is, if you think about it, is like tools, like tool sets around open source systems. For that, those are sort of creating a proprietary tool suite for managing and operating open source systems. Then there's professional services, so offering billable hours, customizing or consulting around how to implement an open source solution. And underneath that is something similar. This is a type of professional service, but instead of the billable hours model, it's perhaps being called paid support, where we're going to pay you, you know, $275,000 a quarter to be on call and guarantee us this may support ours, but it's sort of more like the subscription model. And then, I think this is one of the more commonly used ones that looks like it's being successful now is the software as a service piece, where in effect what you're doing is product bundling, because not only are you offering the software, but you're essentially covering the networking, you're covering the hardware costs, you're covering the support, maintenance, and all the sorts of things that come with hosting and operating software for people. And that's piggybacking on all the cloud excitement and whatnot, and sort of reduces barriers to entry for people who are trying to start their own business, which has nothing to do with the service you're offering. Using ourselves as an example, if we're doing revenue management for publishers, the publisher doesn't have to worry about installing servers, downloading the software, putting up things. They just say, great, I'm going to pay X a month for this service for some capacity, and I'm going to worry about my business, which is publishing, and know that they're on the hook for making this thing work. That's what I'm paying for. It's one less thing that you have to hire for, one less thing you have to plan for, and it's small for a company. Even large companies, as a kind of cost, they want to focus on their core competencies, not spend a lot of time investing in ancillary services. So the pros and cons, sort of the same. I talked a little bit just now about the software as a service, and we sort of came up with shrink wrapping is useless. Tools is a tough one, because I think most people notice that over time, especially as an open source product matures, a lot of the tools just sort of happen naturally. Either they're included in the package, or there's so many community tools that people have built and shared. Like, hey, I have to debug something. Well, look, here's hooray, GDB. It's tough to sort of step into this tool business and be competitive, because over time, those features or those products are going to become free themselves or be part of the overall offering. The professional services, just to sort of like the billable engagements. Well, professional services is a really, really tough business to be in. I guess actually some of you guys are in the professional services business yourself, whether it's installing Linux for a bunch of users or network management or contracting. If any of you guys are contractors, you know that you only make money when you're working. So if you're sleeping, you're not making money. So it's a tough business to scale, especially as you get bigger, and now you have to compete with Anderson and IBM and all these other companies and Infosys and whatnot. Because essentially if somebody's not working, you're not making money. Then there's the support. Support's a bit better because support, you don't necessarily have to staff. You're not doing billable hours, you're doing hour caps. And you're also sort of getting that subscription type revenue, and you're almost selling insurance. Insurance has a lot of value in this world. So you can do much better at capacity planning, controlling your costs, and you can keep selling this service, and then you are making money when people are sleeping, because when people are sleeping and servers aren't crashing, they're still paying for their insurance. So support is somewhere, and support when tied with professional services is a more powerful offering. And then if you take all of those and combine them with software as a service, running the system, which isn't someone's core competency, running it for themselves, that seems to be some of the more powerful ways to get into offering open source as a viable business sort of in this round. Which is technically, so we brought up Red Hat earlier, or Novell's a crash and burn. The sort of the people initially that were just like, hey, here's Linux, we'll tune it for you, and maybe, I don't know, make you feel good about it. So that's kind of a shit business. Because once you're done building something, you're out. Once you've made them feel good about it, you're out. Once they figure out that upgrading the kernel really isn't that hard, you're out. So you really have to say, okay, well, how do I offer these guys more? How do I make myself more valuable to them? And that really is sort of ripping out and replacing things that they have on their own, the services that you're offering, the products that you're offering. The next sort of piece is we touched a lot about sort of the making a decision about why you would do this, and it's sort of like a business and like a very high level product perspective. But then there's the next piece is like the really tangible product implications of doing this. So if you are a product designer and you design the product, this is something now you have to deal with, the fact that this may or may not be open source. And that's where you can get to, are you designing a computer, a consumer product, are you designing a tool suite, are you designing an infrastructure piece? And then you sort of reevaluate your position of why am I open source? So, for example, let's take two things that have very, very different responses, but you can almost argue are incredibly similar. There's the iPhone, and there's World of Warcraft. The iPhone has, an SDK where people create apps. And they're locking in that you can't put flash on it. You can only write Objective-C. And people are up in arms about how it's, you know, oh, well, I creatively, I want to do this, creatively, I want to do that. This isn't totally fair enough to see the threads of it. Then there's world, you know, World of Warcraft, where you can write add-ons, and they must be in Lua. You can only use the APIs they give you. You cannot do anything else, and if we catch you do something else, we're going to ban you and everyone using that tool. We're going to turn it off for you forever. Well, nobody complains about this. They think, oh, it's great. Look, they're letting us do this thing. It's very flexible for us. Everyone complains about this one, the phone. Well, it's still very flexible for you, but they're complaining about it. When you're designing a product from scratch, you don't know which one of these responses you're going to get. And from a pure product design perspective, you're just trying to make your product flexible, customizable. So that's a big burden on the design process right there that you're going to have to deal with. And I don't really have any better sort of lessons in how you deal with it. It's just something that sits there in the back of your mind. Mostly because every product that I've designed, I've inherited as open source. That has been open source. And everyone I work on that has not been open source, we have not been open source. So I've never had to consciously myself make the decision to go one way or the other. But I do think that from the product responses I get, that the one thing I can say that's probably the most key thing to think about when doing this, and I think this might give some insights why you get uproar on one side and no uproar on the other, is how closely is what you're doing tied to revenue, right? If I'm building World of Warcraft add-ons, nobody's making money from that. That's not a business, that's a hobby. If I'm developing applications for a platform that I'm selling, it's my livelihood, there's revenue tied to that, right? That's why I'm screaming about this one. That's why I'm not screaming about this one. If for what we do for you know auctions and revenue serving and revenue decisions and yield optimization, you better believe that's tied to revenue. Like that's tied to a business's money. If we break or there's a bug in our system, people are losing money and they're irate. But if you think of with Thrift, this binary protocol for sending objects back and forth. If that breaks, no one's upset unless it's affecting revenue. But Thrift can break left, right, and center and not really affect the core performance of the product, might just fit some things in the logs. That by itself is going to put people up in arms. That's just sort of the liability or infrastructure piece. And that's probably closer to the example earlier of Linux, not IBM, starting to invest in Linux and solidifying and offer services. At some point, something like Thrift is going to be, how we joke, it's the new core button. But if it's going to be something, this is
the new core button.
Right, it's just protocol, binary talk back and forth. If this is going to turn into something that people develop workflows and develop interoperability on top of, well, guess what? You're going to have Accenture or Linux or IBM, or one of these massive services companies behind it, selling it, supporting it. Because otherwise, it's just going to be a lot of up-and-comers and the guys like Yahoo, us, Google, Facebook that are using it and going off of it. But you're not going to get, Pfizer to install. You're not going to get, more Grumman to use. You're not going to get, I'm trying to pick a bank name that I want to say, and you're not going to get a bank to use it. That's going to be a serious issue. And so another example, too, is Oracle Financials. It's a system that people use for reconciliation, billing, and payments. What Oracle Financials is doing isn't terribly difficult. It's just messy little rats nest of things, but people are willing to pay, ungodly sums of money for it. Because one, it's sort of, especially for a public company, people, there's a whole industry around knowing how to work, Oracle Financials and still keep you like SOX compliant. If it breaks, I'm going to sue Oracle. Oracle's got money. If I'm using some open source thing and it breaks, well, there's no industry around people. So if I go public, my company's growing, and I follow my S1, I'm like, oh shit. How am I going to have to rip out this entire system and put Oracle Financials in? Because one, there isn't, community, there isn't like a professional services community to support the system for me. Two, I can't get insurance because there's no thing, and it's going to make it more difficult for me to go public. And three, if it does break, who do I recoup those costs from? Well, I can't get insurance, and I can't sue anyone. But for a business, for like managing risk, that does even no good. So really, a lot of from a pure product design decision is, many times you get to this open source sort of barrier, or the open source sort of like a decision point, and you really have to think, well, how close is what I'm doing tied to revenue, tied to someone, tied to their business, and that's where it makes the most sense to say, okay,
I'm going to open this thing up purely open source and try to create an entire industry around it, or I'm just going to give people flexibility so they can customize it. That this sort of, you know, then you start with, you know, your vector where you have to figure out what the right decision is. So I guess I'm going to talk a little bit about using ourselves as a bit of a case study, because I think we have an interesting bunch of issues that we work through. The software that we build is about 10 years old. It's been a project for about 10 years. I think when it started, it was called PHP As New, and it changed its name to OpenX. It had several names. Now it's called OpenX. And it was initially started by a company in the UK called Unanimous, which is sort of a media trading group. At some point, they realized that this is not core to our business. It's a tool we use, but it's not. There's probably more value in this and sort of spinning it out as, you know, its own entity, and then we can evaluate what we want to do with it. So they sort of open sourced the whole thing, and it was spun out. And this massive adoption, there's like 150,000 publishers in the world using this software to power, you know, their revenue serving systems. And they're sort of like, you know, the system itself makes, you know, over 300 million decisions a month about what to serve, or it's generating money for these companies. So about 3 years ago, someone said, oh, wow, that looks like a business. So people who spun it out, they got some venture funding. They hired an initial team who just kind of didn't know what to do with it. And 2 years ago, they hired a lot of us here who had backgrounds at Google and Yahoo and building systems that made lots of money for Google and Yahoo and their partners. And the first thing that we sort of evaluated was, oh shit, here's this downloaded PHP footprint that's massive, but how on earth can you monetize all these guys all over the world with lots of opinions, and they've all customized this thing to kingdom come, and how do you update it and not freak everybody? So that's where we sort of came to our own flexibility decision. We're like, well, yes, it's open source, but we still want to have some, in order for us to monetize it, we are going to have to take into account that there's going to be people are powering proprietary systems here. How can we get somewhere where people can integrate this with compiled code or compiled parts of it? And how can we sort of integrate? PHP is there, PHP isn't our, it's not the most scalable thing in the world. By definition, it's an interpreted language, it's not the most scalable thing in the world. And it doesn't give anyone any help in being flexible or customizing. Basically, you can do whatever you can do in PHP, that doesn't guide you. So it's really sort of coming up with strong APIs and plugins that said, we understand this space, we understand what you're likely trying to do, so we're going to give you easy ways to do it, through a plugin framework and through defined APIs. So you don't have to worry about, oh shit, how do I rewrite that function in PHP, because I think I changed something, I don't have to bug the whole system. I can focus on whatever custom piece I was going to do and say, yes, serve, or yes, write to database, or yes, log event. Simple things like that should have been in part of the box. So that's where we came to this crossroads. We're like, well, we have to implement more customizability, which is sort of ironic to say when you have open source software. And it was developing those plugins and APIs, and then understanding that going forward, are we going to start distributing a binary file and not the source by default? And coming to those points, and then also, people. When we hear from customers who stop using, when we hear from users who stop using the software, it's because they got sick of managing it themselves. They got sick of having the network guy and the hardware guy and this guy and that guy. It's not their business. And they spend 60% of their time worrying about this and not what they should be focusing on, which is their traditional core competency. So then the next obvious step was us. Let's offer it as a service. Let's do all the hosting, let's do all the networking, it's buying a service on. And that's worked out very well. However, now the community starts talking. This is a massive change, right? This is a 10-year-old project at this point. So this is 8 years in, and all of a sudden there's a massive change going on. Well, who's in charge of this? Who makes these decisions? Who has the right to change our product, our open source code? And this is, our community is terrific. We get a lot of contributions, a lot of help, especially around QA and debugging and people finding problems before we do. But there's also that sort of wing, the entitled wing, that this is ours and how dare you win. And they're very loud. And that's not something any of us, we used open source software, we contributed. We contributed to the past and lightweight event system and our previous, places where we worked. But we hadn't actually, had to deal with the community. We hadn't had to be like, wow, this is this thing we have to manage. This is this, great beast at this point. In reality, it's not. It was like one sore tooth and a lot of happy teeth. But there's that one sore tooth. So that was figuring out that you can't just sort of you have to be very clear in it. For us, we had to learn that you have to be very clear about dictating who has the ownership of this, who's defined the vision, what types of feedback. And this sounds incredibly draconian, right? If you think of open source as this great community where people contributing, it's like, no, that's not how it works. Who has the right to tell us what we can and can't? Who do we listen to and who do we not listen to? You know, are there sort of, yeah, sure, we'll peruse things, but we're not going to respond to you unless, one, you're brilliant, or two, you've been contributing to this community. You've been helping people with their problems, and you decide that you have value in this community. And these are sort of, I'm trying to address this in the perspective of when I got, you know, interested in open source stuff. To me, this is almost like a total 180. It's this absolute foreign concept where I thought it was, wow, there's all these people doing all this great stuff. And you learn, like, well, you're the one running the thing. It's, no, it's not. It's, there's, you have to define where it's going or it's not going to go anywhere. It's going to spit. In essence, while we did amass this major footprint, you know, we've had to rewrite just about every single piece of the thing to catch it up with our commercial competition, now that we are a commercial entity, and also because we're losing to the footprint was shrinking because of other commercial entities who had a strong defined vision and strong defined purpose. And making those changes is painful. It's very difficult to communicate. So the other piece is that we still want to, you know, the other thing for us is that the open source part is a strong part of our heritage. You know, one, from who we were previously, and then two is the company as a whole, the footprint as a whole. And that's where we sort of made the decision that, yeah, we still have an open source version of the software, but it absolutely lags behind the one we offer as a service. Simply, one, just as a function of we're a small company. We can't have, you know, solving 3, 4, or 5 problems at a time isn't something that we can necessarily do. So you focus on the one that makes money, because if you make money, you can hire more people. If you hire more people, you can solve more problems. That seems sort of obvious. And then two, giving some, you know, there is value in sort of having something first, or having the best, or having things beforehand. So it's easier to ask customers when they have to make a decision. So I can have the really cool thing I want, or I can download this and not be a customer, be a user. It's like, well, it's a business, we want customers. So we absolutely push things first into these hosted and paid services. And this is happening more and more. If you think of like MySQL, there's this, you know, and I think this is the new word. This is like, it's like, you know, it's now like secret buzzwords. It's like community, the community version now. Instead of, you know, the open source projects now have a community version and an enterprise version. Enterprise means hosted or proprietary, or they're counting how many CPUs you're running on and pay for it. We have one. SQL has one, and all these other companies have one. There's a community version, which means there's no support. It's, you know, n number of versions behind. And yeah, you can download it, you can run it, you can do what you want with it, but, you know, financially, you know, one, we can't do anything with it, and two, we have to give you an economic incentive to stop being a user and start being a customer, because we are a business. I think that's the core thing from all of this, is that when you have some open source project, you have, and you want to do it for a living, you have to figure out, how can I do this as a business? Because, yeah.
What do you mean by MySQL's unusable? I mean, community editions unusable?
It only scales to a certain point.
That's not true.
No, it is. If you like, for example, like the version that Google runs, mm-hmm. is massively customized. Massively customized. If you just downloaded it and did what they do with it, dead in the water. The version we had at Yahoo running, massively customized. If we just threw out a bunch of free BSD machines, didn't look at it, and said, yeah, great, that's our database, works, wouldn't work. Go right to the ground. So now, for most people, they will never run into that. But if you think about the volumes that, you know, those huge companies are, you think about like Visa. Visa has a data store. Visa is doing billions of transactions a day. That's not going to work on MySQL. So it's really at that scale, that massive enterprise scale, where you have to provide some economic incentive to move over.
Okay. Is, I was just thinking that there comes a point at which you could cluster things up. NDP is part of the community edition.
Yeah, I was factoring clustering.
Okay.
To that. But there are lots of issues you run into. With all these things at a certain point.
Sorry, I'm the MySQL evangelist, so
you can read it. You mean the Oracle evangelist.
Oh, wow.
Oracle hasn't started paying you yet.
They haven't, but there's a reason they bought it.
But they did pretty much kill off MySQL conference this last time around.
I was a big Berkeley DB fan. I still like Berkeley DB. I bought that too, so I'm with you. So I guess the question was sort of figuring out how to figure out the spun up. It was really like, how do you turn, essentially these things have to be a business if you're going to focus on it. If you don't have the means yourself, if you don't have the free time, if you aren't godlessly wealthy and just think, if you don't have, if you're not a grad student who is writing on a government grant, if someone's not basically footing the bill and you're going to make something you're passionate about, you have to decide, it's like, well, is this a hobby or is this a business? And if it's a hobby, you're likely not going to do it, full time, and may not take it to the full vision that you have, at least in the time frame you want. And that's where these decisions sort of get interesting. A lot of what we had to address, a lot of what we had to communicate to our users. And then the next piece was, how can we offer something that turns more of our users into customers? That was around scalability, that was around advanced features, things that just, for example, we couldn't do. So we built a whole forecasting availability engine. We're running like a massive Hadoop grid. We can't just package that up into the PHP download. One, because likely 70% of the people who download and run it wouldn't have the means to, put it on the machine as PHP. It works. Now you're telling them they have to, install some version of Java, figure out how to configure grid nodes, how to figure out, lightweight event system and compile C journalers and listen to these events and pump them in and take up EFI data feeds and circle them back into your thing. It's like, well, that's a whole different product now. Now you've taken your users, not only are you knowing that you might be thinking you're giving them something that's useful, but they have no way of implementing it. So it's also understanding who these users are and what their capabilities are. So, the other piece that we're trying to solve is, how do we take this essentially PHP download? How do we make it so that we can push compile plugins that might have more advanced functionality, that might talk back to a service on our side that do incredibly complex computations, and then put it back into what's essentially a simple installation on our side? And so that's some of the problems that we're dealing with and trying to solve now, and we haven't solved. That's sort of where we are. And so that I think is a bit of an overview of kind of a lot of the things you have to look at from a business and our product point of view, and how that applies to what we're doing today, and building on top of this 10-year-old open source asset.
Do you really want the community to be working on your projects? Are you more just kind of drawing from what the community's already done? Because as you get into the more complex things that really don't mean anything to 99% of the people, obviously they're not going to be working on that with you.
Right, and essentially a good point. So the benefit of the community for us is two things. Is one, it's for addressing the features that the 30%, the 20% of the paying customers, just not really important to them, but it's important to the sort of a community base where usually most of the local users are. And then two, for us, it's like a flex workforce. We identify people in the community who do decent work, and then we have a professional services team, but when they run out of capacity, it's, hey, we know there's a handful of developers that we trust to edit and code this stuff. Well, we can pull them in, give them a contract, sign the contract on our end, and provide work to them. And that's actually one of the more exciting things too. From point of view, if you want to be involved in an open source project, but you don't really know how, if you're actually really good at this stuff and you communicate with the project owner, I guarantee you, if that project is of value to a lot of companies, that guy is getting pinged six times a day with, can you consult? Can you consult? Can you consult? Can we hire you? Can you consult? Can you consult? Can we hire you? And if he's still not hired, he's probably taking 10% tops of those consulting opportunities. He might want to pass them on. So that's also a good foothold to understand just getting a real inside view. If you don't already have it today, of how businesses are paying for open source software and how they view it and how they view scaling and paying for it.
But do you have to worry about if these people helping you have seen code from a competitor that if the competitor found out that they had worked on your stuff, you might demand that they pull out the trigger?
No, because we don't hire anyone who works for a competitor. And then the other case is essentially, you know, I think we are really the only open source version of this type of software. There might be one or two other really small ones. And in the case where it was someone who worked on DoubleClick or it was someone who worked on Atlas and they want to volunteer for us, that's no different than us hiring. And you know, I remember my first job was at IBM Microelectronics, and that was like, there was the massive chip wars going on at that time, you know, between PowerPC stuff and Intel, AMD, and Motorola, and it was laughable how electrical engineers were just basically spinning between the companies. Now I'm at IBM, now I'm at Motorola, now I'm at Intel, now I'm at AMD, oh, back at IBM. So competitive hiring and hiring, you know, who you're competing to hire their employees it happens in every industry. So, you know, pulling out those guys and bringing them in to
us. But you know, the person you're employing isn't violating an NDA from their company.
That's their responsibility. It's pretty easy for us to identify ourselves against that. It's if they're an ex-employee, if they're an existing employee, like the example we brought with Oracle and Miss Hander, that's when you're in a lot of trouble because they're an existing employee, you should know they're an existing employee, or you do know they're an existing employee, and you're still allowing them to contribute to a competitive product is when you really get in trouble. But if you yourself are violating your own contracts, that buck sort of stops with you. Now, there might be something where the company that comes to you and says, you have to get rid of that code, and then we can counter and say, well, you have to prove you have the rights to it. So you have as a company, have a much stronger position in that case with ex-employees than you do with current employees, you just wouldn't allow them. And that's also something else is that, you know, it hasn't come up, but every single person that we have, I think it's just almost obvious, that we wouldn't give someone a contract who was an employee of the company. Everyone we give contracts to are independent contractors. They just write code, you know, they have a bunch of contracts that work on at any given time.
They don't hold any lock or top one at all.
I think you mean non-compete clauses.
Yeah,
NDAs are very silver compete.
Yeah, NDAs
are
non-compete. Yeah, non-compete.
Not very useful.
Not very useful. NDAs are useful.
Yeah.
Non-competes usually get the shot over the bow. The stop taking on people or you left, you can't hire your friends type of thing. And you're just like, oh, I'll slow down. Send money all over a couple of weeks. Actually, I mean, that seems to be the general.
That's mostly just people being like, I said I would try to hire all everyone I left at it.
That's not what we do. We certainly respect the non-competes, but for us, it's also that in the industry, the people that work on it somewhat small, that, you know, non-competes are kind of like, enough people know enough people. If someone's interested, they're going to reach out anyway. So, or you're going to go to someone else and say, hey, that.
Although that leads me to wonder about non-competes. If you were in Wisconsin and you signed a non-compete clause, then you accepted a position out in California and moved out here. How enforceable is that non-compete?
No, they still drag you to court. I have one in Utah, and they still ask you to come to court in Utah, and nothing comes of it, but they still make you show up. They still get you on something or it is, but they still ask you to come out. You'll get down.
Yeah, I don't pay my travel expenses.
No, they don't pay anything. You have to just go.
Hmm?
You have to just go because then the judge signed in for you to come out.
What if you can't afford to go?
I know people who can't afford to leave town.
That's also the other thing, too, is that lawsuits are usually the outcome of the suit is very rarely the impetus of the lawsuit itself. You're essentially you're playing a game. It's a competitive game where you're trying to get some other outcome. You almost never want to get another trial. You're just trying to outposition, outmaneuver, get this settlement, or get the thing dropped, and then get out. On both sides, it's a tactic. So if you don't have the money to go to Utah, there's very, you know, and unless you have like taken, you know, all their proprietary information and giving it to the company, they're going to make your life miserable, and they're going to make that other company's life miserable. And they don't care if you can't get there, that's not their problem. They're just going to keep suing you guys until they get some other resolution, which isn't you showing up in court, which is you saying, leave there, or you're going to sign over there, or your company's going to license IP from us, so any of your success, we share in that success. That's the goal of the thing.
Well, I think it's actually worse, because if you don't show up to your court, the judge may automatically award the judgment towards the person suing you.
What's the judgment going to be that, like, you can't work for that other company in that other state?
No, it's like you're going to pay the fire, you can't do it, they'll leave the fire wages.
All right,
so it's getting pretty
hypothetical.
It doesn't happen a lot.
Yes. I
hate
to get back on subject, but...
You can't do that. Isn't that
lampshade? I wasn't quite sure what your business model is. Is your core... product, is that open source or is it proprietary? I kind of got the impression that you were just kind of saying at some point it just gets so complex that people can't just kind of download it and use it themselves. They need somebody as big as us to support it.
With the newest versions, the problems that sort of like the more advanced problems we're solving and the newest version of software, we host that. And that's software as a service. A lot of those solutions will likely never trickle into the open source, or the way those problems are solved will likely never trickle into the open source version. The only way they would is if we do have that control of some way to distribute compile plugins, and then people actually hire the service itself and feed machine back to our data centers, and we can put answers back in. And again, it's also before there was no real thought around you're designing what version of the product for, and we put a lot of thought into that now. Where the guys, it's almost if you think of these archetypes of content type providers, there's the way we structure, they're sort of like the tinkerer. There's the very small hobby publisher, and then there's frankly publishing as a business. And publishing as a business for us is, well, that's all hosted, that's all on our servers, that's all the best solutions, the most advanced technology. Hobbyist publishers, the very small guys, just a blog and a couple ads. Well, that's still to us this software as a service, but it's a lighter version and it's free. You can use the software as free. We're not going to charge you for it because we have other products that if you're using, we'll make money off of. Like for example, a market for clearing unsold inventory, where we get a transaction fee. So if you're a small blogger and likely you don't have a sales force, it's like, well, you can still use the product. You'll use our market, get ads, and we'll end up taking 10% of the ad revenue. That's how we make money there. And that also fills a very valuable hole from pure market design. It's sort of like if you think of the head, the torso, the tail of where volume, where players are in this world. The second half of the torso, the tail, sort of like the long tail, that acts as a very strong price support for the head and the top of the torso. So just by the fact of having those players there and having that massive volume, it keeps people involved, it provides liquidity, and it acts as price support for the very premium publishers and the premium torso, allowing them to generate volume. It happens, it's the most supply and demand side. Then we sort of have like the tamper. And for us, that's where we want to continue supporting the open source version. And I think the way we look at it is that, the guys, the very serious massive publishers are not tinkering. They might have dev shops, might have anything, but they're developing their core competencies. And this is not one of them. If this is one of their core competencies, then they're competing with us. So it's really like, people who want to play with it, people who might want to customize it, might want to try interesting things. Even some of the, maybe it's the top publishers who want to prototype something. Say, okay, we got the prototype, we took your downloaded, we have it on one instance, and we prototype, this is how something wants to work. And because the system that we run, the software as a service, is very customizable, we can then, through professional services, customize their instance of the product to do what their prototype is. So that's where, and also getting ideas from the community and finding, sort of like the higher level issues. You may not be able to debug at the very granular level, but you might find some logical inconsistencies with how, objects here talk to objects here, and that's likely to be replicated across the full product suite. So there's absolutely value to having tinkerers, because also they feed into that market that we have as well. That's where the plugins that doesn't have to be compiled, but that's where we can distribute plugins that do happen to talk to these, hosted services we offer to regenerate.
What about a security? If you're having the open source version, I was almost having a code in escrow for them if they need it.
That's actually a really good point, because you can pull from one to the other. Some of the features may not be there, but at least the plugs, the hooks are there. So it's like, okay, there's no forecasting engine in the free one, but you could build or buy a different forecasting engine and plug it in. So, and that's actually, when we talked earlier about the points about flexibility, to race your order, we compete against Google in this arena, and some of the feedback we hear is that I don't want Google owning my data. I'm beholden to them. They have all of my data. If I leave, if I stop using this, my data is gone. From the one, it's on their servers, and two, just from the fact that a lot of this has to do with users, the cookie domain is doubleclick.net, right? I switch, like, I can't read that code. So that ability to sort of be able to pull out and run on your own and then migrate back and have that control, at least the potential of control, is very appealing. And that sort of flexibility, while almost never employed, is a very strong marketing position.
But with any service, you've got that issue.
It's different to varying degrees.
Yeah.
I think because there's such a close replica that's open source that you could then, if you wanted to invest the time and energy into it, there's at least the possibility that you could get to a product substitution on your own servers, with most of it being powered by something that we built. And I think it's that possibility that makes it an attractive one.
Patent issues? Patent issues. Have you encountered? Because I know that's the biggest threat that we've been talking about in the open source community is patent issues.
Yeah, we've filed for our own patents. We filed for patents on things that we're happy to share, and we filed patents for things that we think are going to protect us from our competition. For us, it's the business case when you're going up against these behemoths. You want to throw a couple of landmines out there just to protect yourself, because you know that. At some point you're going to take the wrong customer from them, or you're going to get you're going to hit a little too close to home, and they're going to say, "Oh, throw a couple of layers on. Let's spin them out, and keep them preoccupied." And there are 100 people, we're 20,000, we're 100,000. So you have to, essentially that's something as a company you have to do just to protect yourself. There was some anecdote. It's end hand, I don't know. I think it was Bill Gates going to Sun and going something about, I don't know if you guys have heard this, it's true, but it's a good story. Sort of saying, okay, here are all the patents we have around Microsoft Office and Open Office is pretty young, so we want to talk about the license. And it's, I'll be right back. It's like, here are all the patents we have on Solaris, and here's all the ways where Windows is violating, so we want to talk about that. And they basically just kind of, okay, they both thought. You're basically just protecting yourself. Gives you leverage.
So Google hasn't hit you up or any Yahoo or eBay for any of the auction kind of related patents?
No, our auction stuff doesn't file the patents. And then we patented our auctions, so let's see.
The Yahoo Overture stuff.
Yep, Google has them now, Yahoo has them now. We have a couple pending. Again, the intent of these isn't to, at least,
Your intent, what?
Our position today is not to go sue people, it's to protect themselves.
So, how much of the software base that you're dealing with is open source in terms of rough percentages or not?
Let me try. So the software base, even for the sort of like, let's say we'll call it that sort of enterprise class as a service, how much is open source, how much is it?
Well, I mean, in general, it's like the guys you're paying for to do the software, give me a rough idea of how much of that they're working on open source and how much of it is proprietary.
I'd say the majority of it, I don't think that's an obvious breakdown to us at this point, because what we do is we'll build something that starts proprietary, and then we evaluate what we can contribute back. That's for the core product that we offer. there are at least three, four people at the company that do nothing but work on Thrift, Cassandra, Hadoop, Lightweight Event System, and other open source projects. Like, that's all they do. And so for them, it's full time contributing back to the open source community, just not through our primary product.
So, but at least 10% of your developers are working solidly 100% on open source, then. It's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we certainly, it certainly benefited us. You know, it's given us a very, you know, we have a lot of, there's a lot of goodwill around us in the industry we're in. And a lot of that comes from being, you know, contributing things back to being open, being flexible, and also, you know, the solution we provide, you know, in the past, if you can afford tens of thousands of dollars for a DoubleClick license or tens of thousands of dollars for 24/7, you're shit out of luck. So we filled a very important hole for a lot of people, and even if they may not have had the volume to be, you know, poster or these other things, to them, it was, you know, it's an important endeavor. It's their presence or their small site, you know, their hobby online.
What licenses were you looking at originally?
What licenses? I think we used GPL2 now. I don't remember the exact problems we had. I think there might have been GPL1 and GPL2, or there might have been like some of the stuff might have been a BSD license, and some of it might have been GPL2. And I also think there was some pieces of code that we didn't have explicit ownership for. You know, when it was loosey-goosey, hey, it's open source, it's fun. And then we started going through everything to make sure we actually owned all of it. I think there were a couple of libraries where ownership wasn't clear, so we actually had to track down, go through, you know, Subversion, find out exactly who wrote what, and get them to sign over, like, yes, this belongs to you, it doesn't belong to you, type stuff.
So as a business, you've been working there for about 2 years?
Yes.
So you guys, do you use a lot of open source to support your business in terms of, like, telephone systems and...
Yeah, I think we use open source PBX. Remember what it's called, but it's probably the one that everybody uses. Based on everyone's hold music that I hear on conference calls, it's the same one that everybody uses.
Because I know it's like, that's one of the issues I had when I was putting a startup together, was getting all the other pieces, you know. It'd be nice to get open source as much as you can everywhere else, and some places it was tough.
Yeah, it is. There are some things that are tough, like accounting software is really tough. What do you do? Like, there's not really a lot of packages, and it's not like it's, you can just put everything into, you know, I was going to say Excel, but that's not what it's going to be. You can't put everything into some spreadsheet package. And that's also part of what you think about, sort of that concept of, you know, that tinkerer, hobbyist, publisher. You could easily take that pattern and apply it to, okay, guy trying to figure out what his business is going to be. Okay, figures it out, now you're really small. And then growing with him, and actually now this is an important part of him. He wants support, he wants service, he wants to not focus on the hosting of this, he wants to focus on support competency, and growing that into, okay, now it's a paired relationship. So really, and that's happened with a lot of customers. We start very small, they grow, and because the software is flexible, and because there's different service offerings, you know, in essence, we help them succeed, because what we do is, you know, revenue management, monetizing their inventory. The better we do, the smaller, the better they grow, the bigger they grow. You know, they turn from users into customers, and that for us is a very important, you know, pipeline. Especially if you think they've got 150,000 of these users out there. How do you turn 10% of them into customers, 15%, 20%? So it's just a massive opportunity.
So mostly get customers word of mouth, or?
What's interesting is that we do almost no outbound at this point. It's all inbound. We just hired someone to look at marketing. So it's just been constant inbound. And I think it's because this app, you know, it's been 10 years and there's not a lot of people in the space that have been around for a long time. And there's also, Google owns DoubleClick. Google owns a lot of things. And I think if you guys read a lot of the tech news going on, you see that a lot of the major publishers are very not happy with the way that, you know, their content has been commoditized. When they invest millions of dollars in creating, especially journalists, they view themselves, and they are, you know, the fourth branch of the government. You know, if you think of all the, you know, again, this is, I don't mean mean to be a level-loaded statement, but if you look at the majority of blog sites out there, there's not 1 ounce of original content. It's like 3 snarky comments and then cut and paste from one of these, you know, newspapers, you know, from one of these television news sites. So for them, they also use that their, you know, Google or the search engines have had a major hand in making their content. So, great. There's a lot they could do as well, but it has made a major major hand in commoditizing what's them. It shouldn't be a commodity. It's a non-substitutable product. So they are, a lot of them are looking for alternatives, alternative companies to sort of take out, you know, the solutions that are provided by Google and be able to put a little distance between them.
What do you think about the GPL 3 license?
I don't have to have a...
I'm sorry, I don't know enough about your company, but is it mainly online publishing that you're talking about, as opposed to, you know, like Time Magazine or something?
Well, it would be the equivalent of like Time's online presence. So yeah, it's digital advertising. So the majority of it's the web. There's the mobile piece and the IPTV bit, which is one of the newer things. But
so you're working on like auctioning ad space.
That's part of it. So it's the, if you think of the, so there's a direct sold ad inventory when you power that, and then there's the stuff that's not direct sold, and that's where, you know, you almost think of that as remnant or unsold inventory. That's where you can put it into a market, and that's where we auction that. A lot of the auction mechanics and are similar when trying to evaluate what ad to deliver at any point in time. You're trying to maximize the value long term and short term. So a lot of the concepts and patterns are similar, whether it's, you know, a guaranteed contract with volume guarantees, or it's unsold inventory that's being auctioned in the market.
So who's the customer, the site where the ad is being placed, or just placing the ad?
That phrasing could be the same person. It's the publisher, it's the person whose site you're at.
Okay.
And then they sell it to an advertiser, and the ad you see is what the advertiser wants to show you.
So I've got Times.com, I'm paying you to manage my ad space, for your company to manage my ad space.
Well, if you think about it, it's a large, it's any large publisher, they pay us for the software that allows them to put ads on their site, and allows them to manage and price and forecast and book and deliver the ads on their site, and then also sell the unsold stuff that they can't sell themselves. They have their own sales force that goes out and sells on their behalf.
So you guys don't go out and sell?
No. Well, for the market, we have a sales force that helps sell the unsold on the market. Because they're essentially, to them, this is unsold inventory. You guys put it into a market. The market has its own sales force. But the, you know, market's much more a bidded model, where the a lot of direct sold is called volume guarantees or guaranteed delivery, where people, you know, for some guarantee of volume, of number of impressions, number of pages, or time-based, like for this whole day or this block of days, I will appear, they guarantee, you guarantee the delivery of it for a guaranteed sum of money. And that's where the majority of revenue is derived, from these guaranteed sales. Similar to how the two things that, you know, these content providers are upset with is, one, their content being commoditized, but also their ad inventory as well. And that's where, they're very protective of what they can sell directly and not having their, sort of, it's called channel conflict, where their sales force is competing against other channels who are selling the same inventory. So when they do their management, they make sure that the premium or the prime or the most attractive inventory, so that they exclusively sell on their own behalf. And then the rest is sort of, potentially of lesser value, is where third parties have access to sell to. So they don't end up with someone commoditizing their inventory and packaging across many different sites, or having little insight into how it's packaged and sold. Takes control off of it, which puts God knows what on your site, you know, belly whitening, or lose 15 pounds in 6 days, and date a girl or something. You know, they don't want that on their site because that hurts their users.
How do they control the ads that, in terms of, like, I don't want to see belly whitening ads at all, you know?
Yeah, it's the, so if There's multiple levels of control. The easiest to control is if the advertiser gives you the app, you the publisher, and you serve the app. In many cases, though, the advertiser says, okay, I bought the ad space, I'm just going to give you this tag that's going to load the ad in real time from my service. And then it's a lot harder to control. And the hardest to control is when you give it to something like a market or a network, like some service we offer, where you don't have communication with the direct buyer. And you have to basically tell this market, this third party, what you will and will not accept. And you have to trust them to enforce those rules. And that's obviously the hardest. Because that pattern that you see on the supply side is also replicated on the demand side, where the person buying the inventory may not be the ultimate advertiser, but they might be buying it and reselling it, or buying it and packaging and reselling it to another reseller. So the more people you put in the middle, the less control the primary actors have.
So there's like categories that you say, okay, you know, I like to see these categories on the page.
Yeah, they block out, like, I don't want gun ads for guns or gambling or hate or religion or politics. And explicitly, I don't want ebony ads, and I don't want belly whitening, and I don't want tooth whitening, and I don't want tooth weight loss. And then also, like, competitive exclusions as well. Like, I'm a travel site. I don't want Orbitz. I don't want Expedia. I don't want the competitors there. And then the advertisers as well have their own rules. Let's say there's two ad positions on a page. If I'm buying this one and I'm Coca-Cola, you better not be showing a Pepsi ad over there. So there's just a lot of those rules that each side has about who they want to be positioned with and why.
So that works both on the community version and the enterprise version, or better on the enterprise version significantly than the community version?
That's mostly a function of the market itself, because when you're booking your own ads, you have that control because you see it. There are some tools we provide in the enterprise and the community, but then also similarly for the market. You know, if you're coming into the market through the enterprise, you usually have more controls than if you're coming in from the community. For two reasons. One is sort of like upsell or features, you know, packaging. And then two, because likely if you're coming in from the community, you're smaller, and we're going to have to package you. And it's harder for us to package you with other pieces of inventory to describe you if you have lots of rules, because then you may not match these other entities. And if we can't package you, we can't get decent prices for you.
You get involved with the virtual currency advertising?
No, we have not gotten involved with that. I don't think we will. It's funny. They're running into some really interesting, fun problems with those things. Essentially, they're creating new economies. We have a market, so we're creating some type, you know, but it's using US dollars or UK pounds or euros. They're creating money out of nothing and assigning it to value, assigning it to some good, or assigning it to the dollar, or assigning it to a conversion, which has dollar value. So they're having to manage exchange rates, they're trying to manage, the cost of goods, what you spend that virtual currency on to take it in and out of the market, because it affects the actual ad prices that people pay. And all that virtual currency stuff is just, it's too editorial, I'm not going to say that. A lot of the virtual currency is direct response stuff. So if I can get you to sign up for a mortgage, if I can get you to take a survey, if I can get you to apply for a credit card, if I can get you to subscribe to getting Barscope text messages for $15 a month on your phone, that's what they pay for. And so if you flood the virtual currency market, you're essentially devaluing those activities, or you're just going to spike prices on people aren't going to pay them. So they're creating some interesting problems for themselves. Right? I'm sure they'll solve them. It'll be an ongoing thing. It's never ending. They're going to have a couple of economists that do nothing but work on that.
Oh, okay. Because I used to
Yeah, they took off like the middle of the night. It was crazy. Yeah, well, not in their space exactly, but there's like three spaces in that building, and we're in the other two.
I used to work across the street, and that one was called Friendly, back when that hospital area
was
called Friendly Hills, but of course they kind of have long since gone defunct.
I thought you were going to say you worked in the park, and
no.
You don't look like a drug dealer.
But it wasn't drugs that he was selling, okay? He doesn't like to talk about that, okay?
That was also a free food.
So do we have talk for next month?
We're still looking.
Still looking?
We're still looking.
I always like to ask that question. I don't know. No responsibility on that front.
Well, I picked up a couple of bleeding edge topics from the last MySQL conference, but they're so bleeding edge, not even my boss wants to use them.
Ooh.
It's pretty bleeding edge.
Yeah.
What was I going to say?
I don't know if anyone would be interested in any of those. Like,
all right.
Anyone,
any of the latecomers had links to the news or anything they wanted to bring up?
Other announcement, other than the JP Open House this weekend, we also have the air show in Chino, Chino Airport. So if you're in that direction, that's all the recent show.
Caltech is also having their seminar day. A steep price, but there's a lot of interesting talks.
What's steep?
Free.
Oh.
I didn't think it was free. I thought it was $9.
Oh, well, that's different. I'm talking about one night.
Yeah, that's it.
Anything else? Burke on that one?